request you to kindly switch off your cellular phones. We will be beginning in perhaps a minute from now. Thank you. Major General and Mrs. Chengappa, family members of General Thimayya, Mr. Nandan Nilekani, our keynote speaker, Mrs. Nilekani, Mr. Balraj, Dr. and Mrs. Samuel, the former principals of Bishop Cotton Boys, former and present masters and teachers of the Boys' School and the Girls' School, M. Marshall Manley Warren, Mr. M. G. Mutana, patron of Old Cottonians Association, N. Prakash, chairman, and the managing committee members of both schools, distinguished officers from the armed forces, officers from the Kumar Regiment, Mr. and Mrs. Narayan Murthy, distinguished guests, fellow Old Cottonians, representatives from the press, Rohan, my teammate, and other volunteers, ladies and gentlemen. It is with an overwhelming sense of excitement and anxiety that I address you today. Excitement at the prospects of this endeavor we have undertaken, and anxiety as to whether we shall be able to fulfill our objective. Our objective is to pay tribute to General K.S. Thimayya, an exemplary general, soldier, leader, Indian, human being, and above all, Cottonian. The underlying objective, of course, is to pay tribute to Bishop Cotton Boys' School, Bangalore, the alma mater of General Thimayya, by instituting this memorial lecture series and inviting a distinguished old Cottonian as the keynote speaker. I feel we often tend to forget our heroes. More often we tend to forget our heroes from the armed forces. And perhaps this endeavor at one level is also a tribute to the Indian Armed Forces. I feel humbled to introduce General Thimayya. What we do know about General Thimayya is that he was the Chief of the Army Staff between May 7, 1957 and May 7, 1961, that he was among the first Indians to be trained at the RIMC Dehradun and at Sandhurst, that he commanded 8th Kumar and was the first Indian Brigade Commander, that he was conferred with the prestigious Distinguished Service Order, or DSO as we know it. And this is very interesting, that his deployment of Stuart light tanks at Zojila Pass at 12,000 feet above sea level during the Kargil combat in 1948 is still unprecedented and remains perhaps one of the most legendary maneuvers in Indian military history. That he was the chairman of the Neutral Nations Repatriation Commission constituted in 1953 for the repatriation of 120,000 Chinese and North Korean prisoners of war, and that his deft handling of the situation was described by the US President, General Eisenhower, as one of the most difficult and delicate jobs well done. That the government of India decorated General Thimayya with the Padma Vibhushan in 1954, that his sagacity and experience was counted upon and appreciated by all, not least by the then Prime Minister Pandit Nehru, that after a sparkling career as a soldier and general, he retired in 1961 as one of the greatest generals, if not the greatest. That after his retirement in 1964, he commanded the UN peacekeeping forces in Cyprus and provoked the Turkish foreign minister to describe General Thimayya's role as a superhuman effort to keep peace going, and got the Cyprus government to issue postal stamps after him. That General Thimayya was known as Timmy to his dear ones, and has had at least 4 biographies, subject to correction, written in his memory. But, ladies and gentlemen, perhaps what we need to know about General Thimayya is that he was a true leader who personified the virtues of courage, integrity, wit, humility, and loyalty. That he stood up against any form of injustice, be it racism or mistreatment of his forces. That, perhaps, which is his greatest tribute, is that he was a soldier first and then a general, and hence a true army man. That he, and this is perhaps more meaningful for all of us, was a true Cottonian and saluted the school whenever his motorcade passed the school gates on Residency Road. That he often attended functions, and this I learned from classmates or juniors of General Thimayya, by modestly concealing himself among the guests, even when he was the Chief of the Army Staff. that when he passed away on December 18th, 1965, which tomorrow will be precisely 40 years to the date, his cortege stopped outside the school gates for the school captain to lay a wreath on his coffin, while the students, some of whom I believe are here with us today, paid their last respects from the parapet walls. Ladies and gentlemen, General Thimayya's is a remarkable life that we celebrate today. Through his life, we celebrate the spirit and legacy of Commons, his alma mater to which he was dearly attached. I think General Thimayya reminds us that the school is greater and bigger than all. And it is the place, and perhaps the only place, one learns that character is more important than anything else. At this juncture, we also fondly remember another old Cottonian, Dr. Raja Ramana, Padma Vibhushan, nuclear scientist, and incidentally the former director of NIAS, where we have all gathered today. It is ironic that one of the last few times Dr. Raja Ramana spoke at an old boys event, he reminisced about his interaction with General Thimayya. Both former patrons of the Old Cottonians Association, General Thimayya and Dr. Raja Ramana, remain beacons of the Cottonian family. And alumni are indeed true reflections of their institutions. And in our keynote speaker, Mr. Nandan Nilekani, we have another glowing reflection of Cotton Boys. Though Mr. Balraj, the former principal, from 1970 to 1985, will have the pleasure of introducing Mr. Nilekani to you, I can only say that it is indeed a proud privilege for us to have Mr. Nilekani as our first keynote speaker. As the CEO, President, Managing Director and co-founder of Infosys Technologies, he is a growing role model not only for the corporate sector, but I believe for young Indians at large. It is fitting that we kick-start this lecture series with Mr. Nilekani, as he, just as General Thimayya did, exemplifies leadership and integrity. The topic for the day, corporate social responsibility, emerging leadership trends and issues, is a topic close to Mr. Nilekani. I can say that from experience because I've had the pleasure of profiling him. And it reveals his social commitment through the pursuit of ethical and developmental business practices. And we eagerly anticipate his thoughts on the subject. Perhaps the seeds of corporate social responsibility could be traced to Mr. Nilekani's days in Cottons, because I discovered that he won the Moral Science Prize in Standard 6B. It is truly heartening to see our principals, masters and teachers here with us today. We respectfully welcome them. I think there's no denying they are the bedrock of Cottons or of any institution. We are particularly delighted to have the officers from the Kumau Regiment, which was General Thimayya's regiment. And of course, it goes without saying, delighted to see so many old Cottonians, well-wishers and supporters of this venture, and we cordially welcome each one of you to this special occasion. After Mr. Nilekani's address, we would have about 10 to 15 minutes for any questions for the speaker. And should any of our guests have any recollections or thoughts on the great general, they would be more than welcome, after which we shall adjourn for the fellowship dinner. Ladies and gentlemen, have a very pleasant evening. Thank you for being here. Next Rosen, next semester Rosen.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's both a pleasure and a privilege for me to be among so many distinguished people here. Many old Cottonians, some of whom I couldn't recognize with the passage of time. And these people have distinguished themselves in various fields, as you know. This occasion is in commemoration of the 40th anniversary, the anniversary of one of, if not the greatest Indian general, as was mentioned by Aditya. More than anything else, he was an old Cottonian, and as mentioned before, as he drove past the school gate, he used to salute, I heard. As I was looking through the well-maintained prefect's book in school, in 1921, General Thimayya, who was a prefect of the school, was glad to find So the leadership started at that time. It's significant that the inaugural lecture is being performed here with another eminent Okatalan, Dr. Raja Ramana. Raja was 2 years my senior in college, Madras Christian College, and we kept in close touch even after that. When we were abroad, and then he came back to India again after 20-year absence, we got to know each other again, and we kept in close touch for all the school functions we went together. As I stand here, I think of him. He's telling me about this institute. It was his dream at that time to start in the corner of the Indian Institute of Science before this beautiful building was put on. I feel really a little inadequate to introduce an eminent person like Nilekani. I was, you know, in British history, in 1850s, Sir Robert Peel was the Prime Minister. Robert Peel had the distinction of starting the police system in England. That's why they call Bobbies or Peelites sometimes. Once he was asked, what's the difference between occupation and business? So he thought for a while and said, Britain is an occupation of Greece, but there is no business to be there. I'm not very sure I have very much business to be here, to be introduced to someone whom I had not taught, someone who had known very little, but I'll try my best. The keynote speaker of today's address, Mr. Nandan M. Nilekani, was mentioned as the CEO and President MD of the Infosys Technologies Limited. Infosys is India's flagship company. And what he has done, I think most of us are aware of. He had his schooling at Cotton's until 1967, then went over and finished in Darbar when his father was transferred. Went to IIT Powai and finished his B.Tech in electrical engineering. And soon after graduation, joined Tata Computers. And during his tenure there, I think the seven co-founders of Infosys met and decided to start, I think, I understand, start their first venture in Pune. It moved to Bangalore 2 years later, that's in 1983, presently, and it occupies now, as you know, a 35-acre campus in Electronic City. Nandan is a co-founder of the National Association of Software and Services Company, NASCOM, and a founding member of in US Enterprises, TIE, Bangalore chapter, a non-profit making global network of professionals seeking to promote entrepreneurship. He is also the chairman of the Bangalore chapter of Task Force, constituted by the Chief Minister of Karnataka to improve the much needed infrastructure of Bangalore. He is also a member of SEBI Securities Exchange Board of India, Subcommittee on Insider Trading, and is on the Asia-Pacific Regional Advisory Board of the London Business School. Fortune Magazine clubs Mr. Nandan and Mr. Narayana Murthy as Asia's businessmen of year 2002. Nandan, along with him also, Ms. Narayan Murthy, also formulated a project aimed at raising close to $1 billion for the improvement of the IITs in India. And as a token of gesture, I understand he has offloaded 14,000 Infosys shares worth 7 crores of rupees as his contribution to IIT Bombay. Reports have it that his contribution at the moment exceeds that by vastly, but 4 times. Coming age of Infosys has today bridged the divide between the Silicon Valley and India. And as Nandan points out, one need not be based in Santa Clara to compete and to be successful. You can do that here. He's shown it in his own life. Infosys as a business model is appreciated by the US investors and boasts of a market cap that's larger than its American rivals. It's complementary to Nandan's swell personality, his impeccable public profile and precise execution that he has taken over as the CEO of this company. As an icon of modern corporate India, Nandan believes in high aspiration, perseverance, and creative imagination. I'm quoting from Aditya's version in his unfinished symphony. His tradition of philosophical inquiry has enriched India's to conceptualize software that be more flexible in their approach. With his wide experience, his address on corporate social responsibility and emerging leadership trends is bound to be useful and interesting to us. Mr. Nandan Nilekani.
It's a great honor and pleasure to be here to give the inaugural speech in the General Thimayya Lecture Series. And I'm very grateful to Rohan and Aditya for giving me this opportunity to speak here. Today I'll be speaking about corporate social responsibility, emerging trends, where a lot of the content has been also been created. My wife Rohan has written a lot on this subject. Now, General Thimayya was an illustrious alumnus of Bishop Cotton School. And as people before me have spoken, he was one of India's military heroes and is spoken of as much for his impressive colorful personality as his military record. There's a story that as a young army officer in Allahabad, he once met an elderly gentleman in a cinema theater who asked him how it felt to be an Indian wearing a British military uniform. Thimayya replied with one word, hot. That gentleman was Motilal Nehru. When Thimayya later wanted to quit the army regiment and join the freedom movement, Motilal Nehru advised him against it, saying that a free India would need officers like him. General Thimayya was known for his fearlessness in standing up for his beliefs and convictions. For example, he failed to see eye to eye with India's defense minister Krishna Menon. While General Thimayya faced that India faced a military threat from China, Menon insisted that the threat came from Pakistan and the bulk of India's troops were deployed along that border. Thimayya stuck to his guns and resigned from his post in protest, withdrawing it later only when Nehru intervened and convinced him to stay back. He was eventually proved right in his judgment in the Indo-China war. General Thimayya clearly had a deep sense of integrity, a commitment to doing what is right, and a belief that each individual can make a difference in our society. He was, after all, a Crotonian. As an alumnus of this school, it's a great pleasure and honor for me to be here to give this talk in in the year of Nandan Thimayya's centenary of birth. And as I said, I'll be speaking on corporate social responsibility, emerging trends and issues. While the debate on corporate social responsibility has continued to grow, we remain a long way from consensus on what corporate social responsibility means to the industry. Some view CSR as a broad involvement in community and social affairs and sustainable development. Some see it as sound economic objectives and transparent business practices. Still others see corporate social responsibility as a distraction. The economist Milton Friedman, for example, believes that corporations should operate with narrow goals and that the business of business is business. The economist, for example, states that business cannot be trusted to get CSR right and lack the wherewithal to frame intelligent policy in these areas. The economist Adam Smith, writing in The Wealth of Nations, said, "It is not from the benevolence of the butcher, the brewer, or the baker that they expect a dinner, but from the regard for their own self-interest." So there's a whole school of thought of free market economists who really believe that companies should focus on doing business and leave the business of running the country or society to others. However, the debate surrounding these competing definitions of CSR has also become more complex for several reasons. One is the rise of global corporations, which have become more and more powerful. The second is the increasing impact businesses have on our economic and social lives. According to a study by the Institute for Policy Studies, 51 of the largest 100 economies in the world today are corporations, not countries. The gross revenue of Walmart is larger than the economies of Indonesia and Denmark. British Petroleum is bigger than Hong Kong, and GE is larger than Malaysia and Argentina. Corporations are also increasingly beginning to dominate capital and investment flows between developed and developing economies. For example, at the beginning of the 1990s, private investment accounted for less than half of international money flowing to developing economies. By 1995, private investment had risen to 78% of international investment. What that meant was that international capital flows depended more on Wall Street than on the World Bank. By 2000, the world's 200 largest corporations controlled 28% of the global economy. Hence, you can see that corporations in their size and economic clout had become an increasingly larger and larger part of society. Now, when corporations play such a significant role in our social and economic systems today, they must move beyond the narrow legally defined mandate of merely pursuing economic self-interest. So as corporate influence has broadened, the definition of a corporation's stakeholders has also expanded. Initially, it was just customers, employees, and shareholders, but now the expansion is to include the community and society the business operates in. Consequently, the minimalistic view of the role of the corporation as the self-interest of the capitalist, as defined by Adam Smith and Milton Friedman, can no longer be the valid one in today's world. Therefore, today's corporations must consider the full scope of their impact on society and the environment while making economic decisions. They must balance the need of all their stakeholders with their need to make a profit. They must integrate their economic, social, and environmental goals into a triple bottom line for sustainable growth to ensure development that is truly equitable. It is also a fact that today customers expect the corporations that they deal with to be socially conscious, employees expect the company they work for to be socially conscious, and investors expect the company they buy shares of to be socially conscious. Therefore, there is a complete body of opinion which is leading companies to take a larger role in defining their behavior in society. Now, how can corporations integrate these goals effectively into their business objectives? How can they clearly define for themselves a more responsible, socially responsible role in society? And therefore, we have to really be clear about what do we mean by this animal called corporate social responsibility, because it means many things to many people. Clearly, corporate social responsibility, which is also referred to often as responsible corporate citizenship, is extensive in its definition of the role of corporations in society. It encompasses the following things. Part of it refers to what is called as corporate governance, the way companies are governed. Part of it has to do with sustainable development, to make sure that companies create wealth in a sustainable way in society. Part of it has to do with corporate philanthropy, which is about giving a part of a company's profits for good causes. Part of it has to do with public-private partnerships to enable the best skills of the private sector to be used in public policy. And part of it has to do with corporate advocacy. And therefore, really, when we talk about corporate social responsibility or talk about corporate citizenship, it covers corporate governance, sustainability, corporate philanthropy, public-private partnerships, and corporate advocacy. And we have to look at all these five things before we really understand what we mean in the totality of corporate social responsibility. The corporate governance, which is the first of the five things I mentioned, really defines the goal of a corporation as creating wealth legally and ethically while being fair to all its stakeholders, customers, employees, investors, partners, government, and so forth. And corporate governance encompasses a company's culture, its policies, how it deals with stakeholders, and its commitment to values. Now, good corporate governance is not merely legal compliance. Today, companies who operate around the world are faced varying regulatory, legal, and governance standards. In some countries where they operate, they have the absence of such standards. And therefore, legal compliance cannot be the only basis for defining corporate governance. Because if you focus only on legal compliance, you're really endorsing an ineffective ethical and moral code. Therefore, for effective corporate governance, firms must instead focus on what they define as ethical business conduct, going beyond legal requirements to employ ethical practices that benefit their shareholders, customers, and employees. This will enable companies to adopt uniform standard across the world, even though in different parts of the world, different countries have different legal requirements. So therefore, having one global standard of ethical business conduct is a very important part of corporate governance. If firms just stick to legal standards without looking at ethical standards, they will hurt the relationships with all the stakeholders. For example, if you are a global company that is importing footwear or apparel from an underdeveloped country, while you may be legally following the rules by paying a minimum wage, ethically you really may not be following the right practice of paying them what they should be paid, and therefore you could be running essentially a sweatshop. And therefore there's the whole issue of proper behavior beyond the legal requirement. It's also true that investors, customers, and employees all expect, the trust that good corporate governance builds in investors, employees, and customers is clearly good for the company, and therefore good corporate governance is good practice. Now, at Infosys, we are consistently focused on the highest standards of corporate governance. For example, in 1995, Infosys suffered some losses in the secondary market. Under Indian GAAP, we were not required to make this information public. Nevertheless, we published this information in our annual report and spoke to our shareholders. And we adopted transparency and disclosure standards in India way before they became law. So we believe that setting the standard for corporate governance was very important, even though there was no legal requirement for us to do so. For example, Infosys was the first company in India to publish audited quarterly reports, the first to voluntarily comply with US GAAP accounting standards. These are all not required by law, but it was really pushing the envelope or setting the standard for better corporate governance practices. Even today, we are providing our accounting, balance sheet, and income statements according to the general accounting standards of 8 countries. So by and large, the focus is really to create very high standards of corporate governance so that we have a very highly transparent organization. Now, the second aspect of corporate social responsibility is sustainable wealth creation. The word sustainable is very important because it's not just about wealth creation, but creation of wealth in a sustainable long-term way. And businesses cannot really prosper and create wealth on a sustainable basis unless they make a difference to the context in which they operate. In other words, their future or their sustainable wealth creation is a function of the environment in which they function. For example, in any economy, industrial growth can be significantly impacted by failing infrastructure, low levels of human development, and widespread inequities. Today, in a country which has got 300 million people who are illiterate, affects the ability of business to really have good human capital and is a key bottleneck to our growth. Therefore, if you see the recent NASCOM report about the IT industry, the two big bottlenecks are infrastructure and human capital. Clearly, the larger social context becomes very important. And therefore, corporations must realize that a country's broader social and economic issues are not tangential to business, In fact, they are fundamental to it. And therefore, businesses must address and help address these basic social and economic challenges of a country to ensure long-term sustainable growth. Targeting wider social and economic goals also allows companies to operate with wider room in society. Essentially, corporate involvement in community development efforts create long-term support for such business in the community and improves the capacity of business to sustain future wealth creation and growth. And there are many examples of companies doing that. There are examples like Hewlett Packard pursuing broad programs to help the digital divide. We at Infosys have a program called Campus Connect, where we work with many educational colleges across the country. We help them with education experiences and best practices with faculty, working with the faculty across colleges. We work with these institutions to help upgrade college curriculum and provide access to technology-related information and courseware for students and professors. Now, this, in a sense, combines our interest with the larger interest. By doing what we do, we are expanding the pool of highly skilled talent in the country, which also enables us to get more people in the pool. But at the same time, we are creating a larger pool of people for the entire industry. And therefore, you're able to really combine business goals with larger social goals. Now, the other part is really of sustainable wealth creation is really seeing how you can address a larger part of the people by broadening the access to markets and through innovative strategies. For example, today in India, we have 170 million households earning less than $5,000 a year. And these populations remain at the fringe of India's markets, unable to participate in the economy as consumers. As a result, a whole segment of society is unable to really benefit from the market growth and market economy, which really makes the whole process very inequitable. And therefore, if there are ways that we can broaden our market and provide products and services that enable us to reach out to a larger set of people, then we can really create more critical choices and opportunities for the poor and empower them as consumers. And there's a lot of work done in this field. For example, Professor Prahlad has written about the fortune at the bottom of the pyramid, where he gives examples of many companies which have come out with innovative solutions to empower the poor as consumers and at the same time help address in developmental goals. For example, Grameen Bank, which is Bangladesh's largest phone bank and provides phone access to 50 million people, and by giving women the right ability to buy cellular phones and then rent the phones to their neighbors. That's an example of where a social goal is met at the same time to create a large pool of consumers. Or what ICICI is doing by supporting over 8,000 self-help groups all over the country. These are again examples of where companies are both doing business as well as advancing social goals. The other aspect of creating sustainability is environmental sustainability, which is a very important part of what corporations have to do. This challenge is all the more for companies that are in the business of resources, and therefore we need to make sure that the use of resources is done in a way that is much more in a much more conservative way. And many companies who want to be at the forefront of sustainability have adopted practices that are beyond what is required of them by creating much more sustainable practices. For example, a few years back, British Petroleum came out with a policy that ensured a zero impact of the environment of its upstream operations and made a conscious policy to go towards natural gas, which had less emission impact on the environment. And similarly, HSBC, the bank, came out with a policy saying that by the end of this financial year, they would be carbon neutral, which means that the total carbon emissions they would make would equal what they would have as carbon sinks. And this again is an example of companies trying to be at the forefront of environmental sustainability. Or the development of Toyota of an environmentally friendly hybrid car, which the Prius, which became the fastest selling car in the US. Again, at Infosys, we have adopted what we call as the Ozone Initiative, or an environmental management system to save power, to recycle water, to conserve resources, to reduce waste, and to create a green campus. And this again is something that has brought us in line with global environmentally sustainable standards. So creating a sustainability in the way we do business is another aspect of corporate social responsibility. The third aspect of corporate social responsibility is companies participating in public-private partnerships. Now, what are these public-private partnerships? Historically, if you look at the Western notion of public-private partnership, it's really about using private capital to finance public infrastructure. But the way we are using the term here, we are saying that there is a way to bring the best capabilities of the private sector to improving the quality of governance. Because what companies are good at are efficiency and effectiveness. They spend their time in improving productivity, in having better systems, in making things more efficient, in improving productivity and so forth. And therefore, companies, by and large, have developed a great amount of intellectual capital in improving efficiency and effectiveness. Society is not just about efficiency and effectiveness, it's about equity. It is making sure that the benefits of society reaches everybody. And therefore, there is an opportunity to bring these two things together, to bring the private sector's intellectual capital, its knowledge of implementation and project management, its expertise in creating transparency and accountability, and bringing that to the space of public service. And therefore, public-private partnerships essentially marry the efficiency and effectiveness capability of the private sector with the equitable goals of the public sector. And therefore, an effective public-private partnership is something which has a commitment to producing systemic, scalable, and replicable change, and a long-term strategy to sustain and continue these results. And this, again, we believe is another way that companies can contribute in the corporate social responsibility. An example of that was the BADF, which was a coalition of industry, civil society, and government for Bangalore. And the idea was to bring the best practices in building efficient delivery of civic systems, as well as in creating a pattern of accountability and transparency in the way the city is governed. The fourth dimension of corporate social responsibility is corporate philanthropy, which is company actually giving a part of its profits for a greater cause. And generally, for example, in the UK, companies give about anywhere from 0.7 to 1.3% of the pre-tax profits to different causes. And this, again, at Infosys has been a very key part of our corporate social responsibility. Infosys donates every year a fixed percentage of the net profits to the Infosys Foundation. Sudha Narayanmurthy is here, who chairs the Infosys Foundation. And this was set up in 1996 and focuses on projects for the underprivileged in rural areas, as well as healthcare and education for the poor. And therefore, corporate philanthropy is companies allocating a part of the profits for causes that they believe in, and creating the mechanisms and the foundations to make sure that money is spent for the best purposes that they identify for the poor or for any other part of society they want to provide. So this is the fourth dimension of social responsibility, which is corporate philanthropy. And then the final dimension of corporate social responsibility is what is called as corporate advocacy, which is about companies pushing the envelope in creating progressive best practices in the environment that they live in. Now, this is again a very important part, because as companies, I'll explain in the beginning, companies have become a much bigger and bigger part of our economy. I mean, they become much more influential. They attract the best people, therefore they have a huge amount of intellectual capital, they have a lot of financial resources. But they also have to see how they use that to create a more progressive situation in their society. Now, the thing is that this becomes slightly tricky, because if companies do it alone without creating a climate of opinion for other firms in that market to do that, then it may not necessarily be the right thing for the company, because companies cannot just stand out alone as doing something different. For example, one of the areas where Infosys has been very vocal, and our chairman, Mr. Narayanmurthy, has been very vocal, is that software companies must pay taxes. Because our belief is that software companies are now very profitable, they become large, they have to pay taxes. But we can't go to the government and say, we'll pay you more taxes, if the tax law does not provide for that, because the shareholders can ask us, why are we paying more taxes than necessary? But if you create a climate of opinion that software companies must pay taxes, and if you're able to create a broad coalition of companies that support that, and if that becomes law, then all of us will pay the same amount of taxes, and there's no question of explaining to the shareholders. And therefore, when you want to really push the envelope of corporate behavior, it's not sufficient just to do something or to articulate it, but to actually create a mindset and a climate of opinion, and therefore push the envelope on creating these progressive corporate policies. And this is very important. For example, when Levi Strauss wanted to create much higher labor standards in the factories which they bought the product from, they couldn't do it alone, because if they did it alone, then it would create a competitive disadvantage for them. They again had to create a climate of opinion where a larger set of people started believing in those kind of things. And I think this is very important, because otherwise, I mean, in business you have something called first mover advantage when you well, you know, when you move quickly and take commanding position of a market. But in a companies espousing a social or progressive cause, you actually have first mover risk if you take the risk and do something and somebody else does not come along. I was talking to the CEO of an oil company where they were digging oil in an African country, and they decided that they would give full transparency of the accounting of the oil that they had, because the concern was that the oil was not being used for the development of the country where the oil was from, but was instead going to the pockets of the rulers of that country. But unfortunately, since they were the only company doing that, they were promptly shut out of that country for doing business because none of the other companies came along and did that. And therefore, this first mover risk is very important. And therefore, when you want to push the envelope on this progressive idea, you really need to move carefully. You need to articulate that vision. You need to create a body of opinion, and then only you can really move it forward. And therefore, it's very important to create an environment for change when you want to do corporate advocacy. And I think part of creating corporate advocacy is by being a role model. For example, one of the things which I explained, that while corporate governance was something we talked about, Infosys, again under the leadership of Mr. Narayan Murthy, led the practice of corporate governance. So we did things which were not required by law, whether it was having quarterly audited statements, whether it was having analyst conference, whether it was giving a large amount of information on the web, whether it was giving our accounting reports in eight accounting systems. Nobody asked us to do these things, but by doing these things, you are pushing the envelope on what is corporate governance. And when you start doing it in that manner, it has two impacts. One is that it becomes a role model, in the sense it makes other people say, if these guys can do it, we can do it. And therefore, it creates an aspirational aspect of role model. The second thing, it creates a sense of pressure in the system, because shareholders can then ask other companies, if these guys can practice such high standards of transparency, why can't you? And therefore, this combination of being a role model and also being a point of pressure can act as a way to change the envelope of corporate behavior. And I think that's really what is important. So corporate advocacy is a very, very important part of corporate social responsibility. It's about companies taking a point of view about of how they should run in terms of their governance, or how they should run in terms of their thing with the environment, or how they believe in transparency, or it's about how they treat their employees, or whatever, or it's how they treat natural resources. Whatever be the context of corporate governance, I mean, of these things, companies taking a point of view and really creating an environment in society where what they advocate becomes common practice and often law is a very, very important of advocacy, and therefore is a very, very important part of corporate social responsibility. I think the point is I want to say that corporate social responsibility or corporate citizenship really has five dimensions to it. It's not just one thing. It's about corporate governance. It's about promoting sustainable development. It's about public-private partnerships. It's about corporate philanthropy. And it's about corporate advocacy. And you have to look at all these things together when you start thinking about what is your strategy or what is your view on corporate social responsibility. Now, why do we, I mean, I tried to give you some ideas of why we need to all this, but let me again come back to why we need it in the specific context of India. Now, today, we know that India faces real social and economic challenges. We have 260 million people below the poverty line. We have 39% of the country which is illiterate, and unemployment is around 10%. We will be adding 325 million people to the working population by 2016. Now, people call this as the demographic dividend, because most countries, when they have a large pool of young population and they can create jobs for them, also have periods of high economic growth. But this assumes that you create jobs for everybody. On the other hand, if you do not create jobs for everybody, the demographic dividend can be a demographic disaster, because you'll have a large number of young people without jobs, leading to huge amounts of economic and social imbalances and you know, all the problems that go with that. Now, India therefore has to create, if it's really going to use this demographic dividend in the most effective way, has to create 10 million jobs a year. Today, we are adding only 1 million jobs a year. So clearly, we have a huge challenge ahead of us in raising the number of jobs that we create every year. Now, there's enough proof in the world that the only way you can do this is by raising the rate of economic growth. If you have seen Jeffrey Sachs' book, The End of Poverty, he argues very simply that the only difference between Africa and the West was the rate of economic growth. In 1820, the UK, which was the most strongest economy of that time, in 1820, had only four times the per capita income of Africa. But from 1820 to now, Africa grew at a compounded rate of less than 2%, whereas the West grew at 2.5%. And this compounded change of rate of growth led to, by 2000, the economic per capita income in the US, which was then the richest country, to be 20 times that on a per capita basis to Africa. So the only difference was over 200 years, the rate of economic growth in the West was higher than in Africa. And therefore, the power of having a high compounded growth rate for countries over decades is really the difference between eliminating poverty and not eliminating poverty. The other point is that rapid economic growth also helps address social problems in a society. In the recent book by Benjamin Friedman called The Moral Consequences of Growth, he argues that when countries have periods of rapid economic growth, when people see a significant improvement in their quality of life, it also helps to foster democracy, tolerance, and generosity to the downtrodden. So economic growth is not just about, getting jobs. It also changes the social climate to create tolerance, democracy, and generosity, and in many ways is the best solution to the problems of caste and communalism that we have here. And therefore, we need economic growth both from the objective of creating jobs as well as from the moral objective of creating a just society. And clearly, if you want to address this, we must create those conditions for rapid economic growth, which means we need to create conditions for economic growth at least 10% a year. And as whether it's Adam Smith or Ricardo, all economists have argued that it's the role of business to really create rapid economic growth. Economic growth cannot be created by the government. It has to be created by businesses, by entrepreneurs, to create jobs and create that economic growth. And therefore, because it is ultimately the competitive environment of private enterprise that enables talent to be allocated where it generates highest value, enables trade and capital investment where returns are the highest, it enables a dynamic economy where business experiments are made possible through entrepreneurship. So, to argue is very simple. We have a huge demographic dividend. We have a lot of young people coming down the pipe. If you're really going to create jobs for them, we need to grow the economy at 10% a year. If we grow at 10% a year, we not only create a lot of jobs for these young people, we also create an environment where we have much better tolerance and democracy. To create those jobs, we can't do that by creating government institutions, but to create the private sector. Therefore, the point is that creating and enabling an environment for private enterprise becomes very, very critical if you really want to tackle our problems of poverty. And this, tons of evidence on this fact that as the correlation between creating freedom for business and the fact that GDP growth is higher. For example, there's a study which shows that a country that moved from the bottom sixth in freedom for business to the top sixth could increase its GDP growth rate by an average of 2.8% annually. So clearly, creating that is very important, and we have seen that in India. During the first 30 years of independence, when we had a deep suspicion of private enterprise and businesses are highly regulated and controlled, GDP growth was just 3.5% a year and per capita growth rate was barely 1.2%. After 1997, when we brought in the economic reforms under Dr. Manmohan Singh, we saw that there was a significant improvement in the growth rate. And since reforms, India has averaged an annual GDP growth rate of 6%. And India's per capita GDP on a purchasing power parity has doubled from 1400 in 1991 to US dollars 3100 in 2004. And the poverty rate has fallen from 35% to 26%. Clearly, we have seen the impact even in a limited way in the last 14 years. And we believe that this has to be done even higher. But what this means, and why am I raising this issue in the context of corporate social responsibility? The point is that it's very clear that we unequivocally have to support a create an enabling environment for dynamic business and entrepreneurs to create jobs. But the moment you start giving corporations a larger and larger role in the social and economic life of a country, corporations in turn must reciprocate the trust by responsible corporate behavior. That's the point I'm making, that it requires two to tango. While on the one hand, you will use the private sector to drive economic growth, you also, the private sector in turn has the obligation to conduct themselves in a way that they behave in a much more responsible way by following all the standards of corporate social responsibility. And it's very important that corporations are proactive about these things. It's not about sitting in your office and doing things, you have to be proactive. Because once a society reduces the size of its public sector and public spending, and as the private sector becomes a larger and larger part of the GDP, the society expects the corporate sector to shoulder a lot of the social goals of society. For example, it can do that for the imposition of expenditures on business, it can do that to increase regulation, it can do that by reducing the flexibility for growth. And an example, if you look today, for example, why is it that the government is asking for reservations in the private sector? Why is it that we have an educational stress on corporate taxes so that we can fund the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan? It's because as the private sector becomes a larger and larger part of the economy, society starts expecting the private sector to play a larger and larger part in deploying and being a part of achieving social goals. And therefore, companies cannot sit back and say, we'll do our business and we'll go home. Because if they do that, then if they're not proactive in partnering society in development, then they run the risk that instead of them deciding the agenda for development, somebody else will decide the agenda for development for them. And therefore, corporations must proactively embrace social goals as part of the business objectives and foster innovative corporate strategies for equitable growth. I believe that Indian businesses today have this opportunity to help create these kind of partnerships. At the same time, there is a very thin line between corporate social responsibility and corporate individual goals. There's a very thin line between advocating policies of public policy and lobbying for private benefit. There's a very thin line between public-private partnership and private capture of public priorities. There's a very, very thin line between genuine CSR and just doing reputation management. So clearly, therefore, when companies do these things, they have to be from inside, it has to be the moral justification and not purely for reputational reasons. But I do believe that given the fact that the private sector will have to play a bigger and bigger role in India's future, it's imperative that companies be much more proactive in taking a role in leading the whole issue of corporate social responsibility and align its business and its larger goals with larger societal goals and bring its knowledge, its intellectual capital, its power of globalization and help in eliminating poverty, combating illiteracy and driving economic growth. And therefore, I think we need to use our strengths and abilities to bring about dynamic, positive change for both our corporations and for our country. Thank you very much.
Participation and share in the GDP of countries. I think it's time that corporates also now enter the political scene to contribute to the welfare of the country. What is your opinion on
that? I don't think corporates should enter politics. I don't think that's their job.
Should they not play a part in the political scenario in a country?
I think the role of corporations, the role of government is different. The purpose of government and political leadership is to create an equitable society and enabling environment for all businesses to do their job. And the role of business is to not only do their own job well, but to be a good corporate citizen. But I think going beyond that would really, I think, not have the most desirable consequences, because as I said, in this whole area of corporate social responsibility, there's a thin line between advocacy and lobbying. There's a thin line between public-private partnership and public capture of private capture of public services. So I think there has to be a clear arm's length relationship between business and government. At the same time, through the process of corporate social responsibility and corporate advocacy, I think companies have to be more proactive in aligning their goals with larger social goals so that they are able to achieve national goals of eliminating poverty and achieving economic growth. So certainly they'll do that, but I wouldn't advise them to dabble in politics. Yes. Yes. I think, again, a lot of that has to do with public policy, not about corporations, because today you have a GDP where you have two-thirds of the people in the rural areas, but they contribute only a quarter of the GDP, right? 25% of GDP is the population. But the reality is that you cannot change that without urbanization and industrialization. That's what has happened in every country in the world. Already in India, urbanization has gone from 15% in 1947 to about 30% now, and expected to go to about 50% in the next 20-30 years. So the way to do it is really, if you create an enabling environment so that companies can set up, you know, industries that create jobs for the people so that they can move off the farms and so on. And then companies can come in and create jobs and factories. But otherwise, you need to create an environment around them which enables them to do that. If companies don't want to expand because of inflexible labor laws, then, you know, there's nothing that, you know, individual companies can do. So I think if there's the right public policy framework for job creation and industrialization, then automatically some of the problems you mentioned will get solved. I don't think the solution is companies go and do a lot of things in the rural areas as part of the business, unless there's a specific business goal that they will accomplish by that.
Good evening. I have a suggestion. Like, we are on the land of the Tata Institute. The Tata Institute was created with an endowment. Now in India, like in America, you have the Yale, the Kellogg's universities and all that, which are deemed universities. How is it that industrialists and information technology people are not sponsoring deemed universities? Because one thing you require is technical inputs, where you require people who are business friendly. The education pattern should be absorbed in the environment of the workplace. Too much of academic work is not going to help. So we should come forward to sponsor some educational institutions around India, which are nascent, which are started with new institutions rather than sponsoring old alma maters. So I would suggest something like the Tata Institute being created around India.
No, I think, again, you must distinguish between corporate philanthropy and personal philanthropy. I think they are two different things. You need to look at the Institute of Science, it is really a personal endowment by Jamshedji Tata, which made it happen. I think companies, while they must practice corporate philanthropy, cannot do it beyond a particular point. Because at the end of the day, you know, the profits they generate are primarily, you know, for the shareholders. So they can allocate a certain part of the profits, whether it's 1% or whatever. But beyond that, it's difficult for companies to give. On the other hand, individuals who are benefited, they can do whatever they want with the money. And I think that is something which will happen, where there will be more individual contributions to educational institutions. Yeah, so I think it's really in the space of, the Kellogg School is set up by a foundation, an endowment from Kellogg, the founder of Kellogg, so it's not from the company. So I think the point is that individual philanthropy will drive it rather than corporate philanthropy. Somebody over there, maybe at the back of this.
Sir, don't you think that it's difficult for small-sized enterprises and large enterprises to actually, and startups, to focus on corporate social responsibility?
So you're talking about small guys or large guys?
So small and medium-sized enterprises and startups.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think you're right. I mean, some of the principles I talked about may apply to larger companies, but certainly those dimensions of a company in terms of its corporate governance can be from day one. I mean, at Infosys, the principles of corporate governance that were enunciated have been followed from day one. So when the company was less than 10 lakhs revenue. So I think corporate governance can happen from day one. Having a view on the environment can happen from day one. Obviously, things like public-private partnership and philanthropy and advocacy can only happen when you become bigger. But there's certainly the basic principles can definitely be enunciated at the inception or even when you're small.
Sir.
Yes, sir.
May I?
Yes.
My question is I've got a question which you may not wish to answer. Forgive me, because your enunciation was excellent and I've understood all of it. There is just one little thing that seems to worry a person like myself, and maybe you could throw some light on it, please.
Sure.
Sir, a great deal has been written about doomsday, and we're on that path, meaning the amount of energy that is going to be available in this world is diminishing, no matter what we do. Would you like to say something on that? When I say energy, I'm referring to hydrocarbons, which means you cannot make a motor car. You cannot do what you're doing. And you use the word sustainable. Would you like to pass a comment
sure,
on this?
I'm not an expert on energy,
please
so...
Forget it.
I mean, I'll just give you a layman's view of that. I mean, I agree with you that energy is a big issue, and we can't have 5 million people all driving SUVs on the planet. I mean, I agree with you, that's unlikely to be possible. But I think, there are different schools of thought. There are some schools of thought that believe that, there's going to be a serious energy crisis. There are others who believe that there are new forms of energy that will come about. The nuclear is one, solar, fuel cells, and so forth, which will allow us to transcend this. But I agree with you that, in general, we should look at more sustainable forms of development, and certainly companies have an obligation to also create a culture both within themselves and as advocates to create a more sustainable form of development which is much more energy efficient. I think that's definitely true. But what is the long-term view on this? I'm not really an expert on that. Yes, sir.
One of the important principles you mentioned was the public-private partnership. You also mentioned that the private sector could bring efficiency to the public sector and help government, etc., in social activities, etc. My concern is, considering the kind of lack of efficiency that you have in government, etc., in your own experience, what are the insights you can give about where there has been a conflict between the efficiency of the private sector, the lack of it in the public sector, and what problems have you faced in going about whatever tasks you have to achieve?
So I think the basic disconnect comes from the efficiency, effectiveness, and equities conundrum. That is, the private companies focus on efficiency because they need to become more productive, they need to be more profitable, they need to get better return on the capital and so forth. And they also focus on outcomes because they want to make sure that when they make a particular investment in something, there's a result which is commensurate with that investment. However, by and large, private companies don't focus on equity as such. Right? And when we hire people, we don't say, let us make sure that we hire enough of different communities so that we get equity. We focus on getting the best people in the country. And therefore, the private companies have a larger focus on efficiency and effectiveness and less, in a sense, on equity. Government, unfortunately, government, on the other hand, is all about equity, right? If you are elected, you have to make sure that you satisfy everybody. You have to make sure that people who feel disadvantaged get a sense of advantage. You have to make sure that people who who don't have an opportunity to come out. So a lot of the focus is on equity, often at the cost of both efficiency and effectiveness. And therefore, the fundamental disconnect is because the prime set of incentives are different in the two things. Having said that, I think the way that, my experience, the way you can align that better is ultimately democratic governments respond to incentives in the sense politicians across the world like to be re-elected, and that's true whether it's in India or whether it's in the US or wherever. And they will get re-elected because they meet the aspirations of the people they serve. If they don't meet the aspirations, they will not get re-elected. And therefore, if you can drive the aspirations of people towards developmental goals, then politicians will focus on developmental goals. And once they focus on developmental goals, then they'll bring in the tools of efficiency and effectiveness into the way they govern, which is not true today, so they're not really driven by that. So I think the sense I get is that if you can really focus more on developmental goals, and I believe a lot of that can happen by creating far higher transparency and accountability in the system, which we can do today using technology and all that, that will then drive the paradigm towards developmental goals, which in turn will then drive the system towards efficiency and productivity. If you don't address the incentive structure, no amount of lecturing on how to use PERT, CPM, or project management techniques is going to solve the problem.
Firstly, thank you very much for an enlightening talk. But you know, one of the things I wanted to it's not really a question, it's a comment. What I was struck with is your emphasis or the mention of the word demographic dividend. Now that's really a very live issue in this country. We have the youngest population in the world. And the question is, how do we reap this demographic dividend? Now one of the answers I think you gave is that you've got a high rate of economic growth, so you can absorb the young people coming. But I think an equally important thing is educating this young population. And here, I think, with the exception of Infosys and a handful of companies, really Indian industry has not, I think, they've not identified this problem of how do you educate this population. I'm sure you're aware that 200 million, of the 200 million children who enroll in primary school, only 3 million come out of university. 50% don't even make it, that's 100 million don't even make it to secondary school. And really, one of the big losers in all this is industry. Because I don't believe that unemployment, that there is unemployment in India. I believe there is unemployability in India. And it's because of this lack of awareness in politics. Politicians are notoriously unappreciative of the importance of education. But industry, perhaps, that's where the advocacy role of companies, as you, one of the things that you mentioned as part of the corporate responsibility. I think industry needs to play a much greater role in advocating education, quality education for all, and perhaps making this happen by using its influence so that we can reap the demographic dividend. I wonder if you'd like to comment on that.
No, I agree with you. I mean, I have no disagreement with what you're saying. It's just that, I mean, companies cannot subsume or take over the role of government. I mean, you can't expect companies to now take over the role of primary education. It still has to be a public function. You know, providing access to education is really a public governance function. But I think there is definitely a role in advocacy, in bringing a much more light on this matter and creating a sense of urgency, which I agree with you that we should do more of that. At least we try to do that at Infosys, but certainly I think it has to be a larger program. I agree with you. Yes, sir.
One of the things that I'm really impressed with is the very high-minded quality of the leadership at companies like Infosys and so on. Now, I live in the US, and there we have companies which are bailing out of their pension plans and phenomena like that, lobbying against foreign Indian people who don't have medical insurance and so on. So it is. Is corporate responsibility something that we have only when we have high-minded leadership? Or how do we make it something systemic that so that it becomes universally the norm
Or do we just have to wait for great leaders who may, you know, there's a Chinese proverb that says you get a good emperor every 500 years. So do we have to, is that more, or how do we make it the norm? How do we make it routine? How do we build a system that ensures that we unfailingly have corporate governance, or at least the high probability?
Well, actually, I don't know about, I can't speak for the US. In fact, I remember when Infosys went public in the US in 1999, all the bankers said, now we're going to continue with very high corporate governance, better be careful kind of thing. And then of course, after that, all the Enrons of the world happened, so. But I think, it's not that I think, I can't speak for that. And then I think there are some great corporate leaders in the US. They're tremendous people there. So while there has been a whole spate of, you know, abuse and scandals, there have also been some great leaders. I won't tar everybody with the same brush. But you go back and look at the US 100 years back, a lot of it was actually enlightened corporate leadership. I mean, if you look at the contributions of Carnegie, and of course, what he did in building his steel empire was something else. But in the latter part of his life, he was one of the world's biggest benefactors. You know, he set up so many universities, so many things that he did, libraries and so on. Or what filing did in setting up some great institutions. So there have been enough high-minded or visionary business leaders in the US in the last 100 years who have combined good business practice with advancing the envelope of social behavior. I think in the Indian context, it becomes more critical because you are a country which is in some sense in an early capitalism mode. You are essentially, if you look at it, the post 47 era was really a recoil against, you know, capitalism, imperialism, globalization, whatever, empire and all that. And therefore you had a very inward focus, right? And now you are making some baby steps towards a much more market economy where private sector plays a bigger role. Now, the reality is that this model is not yet widely accepted. The whole reason why government seems to do reforms in the middle of the night is because they don't believe that the public wants reforms or that reforms are really good for them. Therefore, it is even more incumbent on private leadership at this stage of development to be even more proactive in the right espousing of corporate social responsibility, because you want to create a model where the larger population understands that this is a good thing for the country and that because there is enlightened corporate behavior, it makes sense to increase the pace of creating a larger role for the private sector. So strategically also, India is at a point where this has to happen, because if you don't do that, if corporate behavior at this critical juncture is an abuse of its position, if it's just a display of conspicuous consumption, then you will have a set of reactions against that, which will in fact kill our attempts to create a more higher growth economy in the private sector. So I think even strategically, it's very, very important that India at this stage and corporates at this stage provide a very high level of corporate social leadership. I don't know. How to make it a norm, I don't know.
Actually, we'll take maybe just one more
question. Sure. You decide which one. Maybe two wrong. 1 year and
one. My question is in the context of this, the World Boys Association, where we now gathered recently. How was your career planning done, and what is the secret of your success?
Well, my career began when I walked into Mr. Narayanmurthy's room one day in 1981, 79, because I came out of IIT with no particular purpose in life and wondering what to do, and I went into his office and he gave me a job on the strength of my GMAT scores because my grades were not very good, and that's how I really came to where I am. So you can ask him what happened. Well, I didn't plan my career. So. Last question.
I've been inspired by what you have told us. But I'd like a slight historical caution. When we grew up in India, up to post-47, the president was socialism.
Yeah.
We're all socialists now. Now we are all Democrats and liberals now. I'd like to mention to you
there's no guarantee in the years to come that we have liberal democracies all over the world. And some of the fun and games that governments play with each other will not be played by corporates. So it's a very important point to bear in mind that the new mandarins, the corporates, they should not think that they are there to take the place of inefficient governments. And they are very much more fair-minded. So a particular distance has to be kept. This is a very important thing.
Sure, I'm not suggesting. I kept saying it's an arms relationship.
And that's why I said I'm not questioning you, but it's something I've seen it in a lot of countries. And when we're all socialists, we're bad enough. And we're all corporates, it will be much better. So you should see your social role in India in that context. Secondly, especially the pressure on the corporate sector to start absorbing people from the less competitive strata of society. Having been in the Ministry of External Affairs and Government, I can tell you one of the most important things is when you get people coming from, I don't say caste quota because you can't accept it, yet make the most efficient test for them. Let them never get promoted on the basis of a quota. Because there is nothing better for an organization to see people who come from handicapped, or shall I say backward strata, but whose criteria for promotion are the highest. Because people then don't point out to them, he belongs to this SC. One of the greatest things you can do, especially in a high-profile industry like yours, is when people come from those strata and they get promoted, it's always meritorious.
Yeah.
That's all. I thank you for everything as an old Victorian.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Actually, Aditya and I, we have a small memento that we thought maybe Mr. Chengappa would like to do the honors and hand over to Nandan. Mr. Chengappa and the General's family, and of course to Mr. and Mrs. Nilekani. Nandan is actually not well today, and which is why we had to cut short the question after session, and for him to stand up, for almost an hour, and to speak and to take questions, we are very grateful. Just a few more thank yous. Thank you to NIAS, to Captain Joseph, to Ramesh, our web designer. I don't know if you're here, but thanks a lot. To Kiran Dattar, actually it turns out that the lecture was being webcasted for our old attorneys in the US as well. And so I think a bunch of them tuned in. So thank you to Kiran Dattar from WebEx for arranging for that. A special thank you to our former wardens and teachers who are here. I think it really means a lot to us. When some members of this, the administration from the school show up. And we're very grateful. Dr. Iqbal Ahmed is somewhere here. Sir, many old boys are very happy to see you after so many years. Thank you, Dr. Balraj. Thank you, Dr. Francis Samuel. And if I've missed anybody else, I'm sorry. Thank you to all World Cretonians and to your families and to anybody else who are missing out on this list. And most of all, thank you, Aditya. I think Aditya has been doing groundwork for all this. It's been, the invitation cards put my name on them, but it's really been Aditya, right? It's easy for me to send emails and so on and say, we're doing fine, good job, but he's really been doing a good thing. So we have a fellowship dinner out here in the greenhouse, what is it called? Green something, it's right outside. And so if you could join us, that would be great. And thank you all once again for coming.